blood pressure. So what special care to be taken in managing pregnancy induced hypertension, and what are the challenges? I pose this question to Dr. Parvati. So Dr. Mohan Rao, the most eminent gynecologist,
so will elaborate in general, this question. So there are about 6 to 8% of pregnancy-induced hypertension cases. That is a routine observation as per statistical data. But there is a difference between a normal patient having blood pressure and a pregnant patient having blood pressure. Pregnancy is a special condition where there are hemodynamic changes in the lady, like hyperdynamic circulation, increased volume, and other features of pregnancy. So having high blood pressure, there are much more complications for the patient. So prior to 20 weeks of pregnancy, we should take the blood pressure and see whether this particular patient has got previous blood pressure or not, increased blood pressure or not. So this comes under chronic hypertension. Suppose if the patient is already having hypertension, but it was not detected, and it is only detected after 20 weeks of pregnancy, then we say preeclampsia or PIH, pregnancy-induced hypertension. So this hypertension was not there before pregnancy, and after the onset of pregnancy, after 20 weeks only, we could come across this sort of problem. This is what we call this as pregnancy-induced hypertension. Suppose if the patient have chronic hypertension, in addition to that, pregnancy-induced hypertension in terms of preeclampsia. This is also another term. This preeclampsia is also one type of pregnancy-induced hypertension where the classical features of preeclampsia once were thought to be triad. So one is hypertension, and the other one is proteinuria. So excretion of protein in the urine, if it is more than 300 milligrams per 24 hours, that is also considered to be a proteinuria. Dipstick method of urine testing shows 1+. That's an indication that the patient is having proteinuria. So these are the features. One, the diastolic pressure should be more than 90 or above. And if it is 140 or above, systolic. So this again shows that particular patient is having hypertension. So coming to the edema part, so this triad of hypertension, edema, and proteinuria. So edema part, once it was thought to be a required feature to say that it is a case of preeclampsia. But nowadays, because this edema is seen in most of the cases, even non-hypertensive people also, we can come across routinely in pregnant patients about the edema, usually after 20 weeks of pregnancy. So that is not taken into consideration as an important point. So what special care to be taken in managing pregnancy? Because the complications in case of PAH, so suppose if it is not detected early and if it is not treated properly, they are likely to go into eclampsia. It's a condition of seizures. So, which is likely to have a poor outcome as well as for the patient as well as for the fetus. So there are so many complications like fetal problems, usually IUGR, so intrauterine growth retardation, because the placental circulation is very much affected. So there is likelihood of getting IUGR babies. And also sometimes if it is when the circulation is so badly damaged to the fetus, sudden IUDs also can occur, intrauterine deaths also can occur. And there is a likelihood of getting oligohydramnios. So these are some of the problems. In addition to that, suppose depending on the duration of the disease, so kidney also can be affected, so to some extent. So with all these things view into mind, we have to definitely detect the cases as early as possible, whether it is a chronic hypertension or sometimes superimposed preeclampsia. Already patient is having chronic hypertension, but added to that, there is proteinuria, and also there is edema, and all other things will be there superadded onto that. So that such cases will come under as chronic hypertension superimposed on preeclampsia. So definitely, pregnant patient needs so much of care, and most dangerous complications like HELLP syndrome are also another other component, serious forms of pregnancy-induced hypertension, which is a grave disease with thrombocytopenia and kidney damage. Patient may go into shock, and there could be elevation of liver enzymes, and also severe sepsis could be there, and there can be a kidney damage can be there. So these are all serious type of things, and also patient can have this eclampsia, that is seizures. So preterm, sometimes preterm deliveries also can occur, abrupt show placenta can occur. So there are all other complications of severe forms of pregnancy-induced hypertension. So it's a very vast subject. We cannot tell all the things. So to some extent, I could clarify these things.
So nowadays, you suggest that we can ignore edema feet?
Edema feet can be ignored if the other parameters are normal. Mm-hmm. Suppose if the patient doesn't have any hypertension, if the patient doesn't have any proteinuria, so this physiologically edema can be there. So see, other conditions like anemia, hyperproteinemia, like things also could be checked, and they can be treated as well. So pregnant patients, because of the hypervolemia, they are more prone to get this hyperproteinemia and anemia. So those things also can be corrected in spite of
Regarding this proteinuria, simple dipstick test is enough, or you suggest 24-hour urine protein excretion?
That is better. Dipstick method is only a rough method, to have an idea. So what are the other challenges? So these are all other problems. So we
proteinuria part. Instead of 24 hours urinary protein, that is a cumbersome procedure. Most of the people are not willing to collect urine for 24 hours. You can take urine protein creatinine ratio, which is for
more helpful.
Spot sample. You can diagnose on.
I mean to say that simple dipstick test, we cannot rely upon it, I think.
No, it is not only to say just to have a suspicion. You have a suspicion and to go for another test. It's only a screening test, you can say.
Because of the during pregnancy, there will be hypervolemia is continuing during pregnancy state, and because of that one, there will be some physiological edema will be there, and this physiological edema usually differentiated from the pathological edema by pitting edema bilateral, and it is not more than above the knees. That's how we will differentiate from the clinical physiological and pathological edema. And with the urine proteinuria, and usually we will be testing the patient with the simple dipstick test. But 24 hours urine test we are not at all doing, because if at all 1 plus urine proteinuria is there, definitely the patient is having this type of renal pathology, maybe 1 month or 2 months before. Then only the urine proteinuria will be excreted. That's why we should not delay the management of that patient as early as possible. We have to deliver the patient. That's why we should not delay the diagnosis by doing a 24-hour sample urine proteinuria test like that. And of course, renal function tests are better to manage that patient, whether serum creatinine is within normal limits or not. This is how we will manage. And the challenge over the pregnancy-induced hypertension nowadays is to have a healthy baby and healthy mother. And definitely, when there is a PAH, the patient has to be delivered as early as possible. If the patient is developing pregnancy-induced hypertension or a preeclampsia or eclampsia, it is, if at all, at 32 weeks of gestation, we cannot deliver the patient because the baby may be preterm. The baby may die. And yeah, of course, in the case of eclampsia, the management treatment is immediately deliver the baby. In case of abrupt show placenta, because of PAH, definitely you have to deliver the baby as early as possible. But in those cases, the baby will definitely suffer. But the ideal time, ideal challenge is to deliver the healthy mother as early as possible so that the baby and mother will be safe. After 37 weeks of gestation, we have to deliver the mother. But it's very difficult to manage that case to have a healthy mother and a healthy baby because of serious complications like DIC and abruptio placenta and HELP syndrome. That's a challenge to the obstetrician. Right, sir.
I am very happy that my simple question evoked much interest among the medical and the faculties, and still Mohanra wants to say something.
The very aim of a patient having this preeclampsia or eclampsia is to save the mother first and then the baby. So before 32 weeks the management is different, and after 37 weeks cesarean section is better so that the mother can be at a safer stage, and also we can have a good survival of the baby also. So suppose if there is eclampsia, there is no question of seeing for the baby's outcome. So mother is most important, and we have to at any cost try to save the mother first. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mohan Ravar. Now we skip to the next question. How common complications are the vulvar anomalies occurring during pregnancy? So the all questions are revolving around pregnancy only. Should we consider all the vulvar heart diseases serious which develop during pregnancy? Dr. Sintan Bhaskar will be able to tell.
The most common common vulvar disease in pregnancy will be like rheumatoid mitral stenosis. If there is a rheumatoid mitral stenosis, rheumatic mitral stenosis, all patients should be screened with a 2D echo. There can be as silent mitral stenosis can be there. That usually by the pregnancy reaches 24 to 28 weeks, then patient will be symptomatic. Hence, all pregnant ladies should be subjected for screening 2D echo to rule out mitral stenosis. This is one better option to prevent pregnancy mitral stenosis related complications. Second one, if the valve is not calcified, it is a mobile valve with a stenosis, then balloon valvuloplasty can be considered in between 18 to 20 weeks of pregnancy. If there is a calcification and severe mitral stenosis, if it is early pregnancy, we can terminate pregnancy, or if it is third trimester, then we have to reduce the labor time by going for forceps delivery, and the just prior to labor, if you can give one shot of heparin, that will be good to prevent thromboembolic complications, which is safe too. Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Bhaskar Rao Garu.
One minute. Because the valvular heart disease complicated the pregnancy complicating cardiac disease, it has a greater mortality when compared to the other diseases. Usually 35% to 40% of mortality is there during the pregnancy. Usually rheumatic valvular heart disease most commonly is mitral stenosis. And during at 31 to 32 weeks of gestation, where there is a hyperdynamic state maximum during the pregnancy period, and we have to be careful at that period. And during labor, in the second phase, and after the delivery of one day after delivery, in these three periods, we have to be very careful so that the patient may not go for a failure. These are the three areas we have to be very careful so that the patient may not go for a failure. Congestive heart failure.
Another most common entity we do miss in a general practice, all pregnant ladies should be prepartumly subjected for 2D echo to identify early cases of prepartum cardiomyopathy to prevent complications during cesarean sections. You might be knowing recently there was a circulation in the WhatsApp also. Prepartum cardiomyopathy may not be that much symptomatic, as patients may have cardiomyopathy, but there will not be any breathlessness signs, or it could be misinterpreted as GERD, as patient will complain some epigastric discomfort. Most of the time they will be given with antacids, PPIs, leaving alone this possibility of prepartum cardiomyopathy. So if a gynecologist is not going to consider for 2D echo, then he may land in trouble after doing cesarean section, then he has to call cardiologist. All cases before subjecting to cesarean sections, they should be subjected for 2D echo to screen prepartum cardiomyopathy. As well as if there is immediate postpartum also, if patient complains of any chest discomfort or little bit breathlessness, we have to always consider for 2D echo to rule out peripartum cardiomyopathy.
Dr. Mohanrad, in this aspect, you agree or contradict the statement of Bhaskar Rao? Panel discussion talaga undal mari.
See, actually, no.
Because the peripartum cardiomyopathy is the one of the complication after delivery, and we have to suspect the one of the differential diagnosis of a cause of breathlessness, and we have to be very careful. And if the patient complains of breathlessness immediately after delivery, or 1 week or 15 days after delivery. That's how we have to differentiate this breathlessness from the any thromboembolic manifestation or from the cardiomyopathy. And we have to go for a 2D echo in the region.
We go for next question. Because the answers to this question seems to be endless. So what is the next question? It has been seen many times, GERD patients, GERD you know, gastroesophageal reflux disease, have cardiac complications. So what are the common cardiac complications seen in patients with GERD, and what special care these patients require? This part I don't have much idea, because GERD is GERD and cardiac complications are I don't know any, there is any relation between them. But you want to add anything for that?
Yes, sir.
Tarunji, do you have any knowledge
physician,
about this?
Physician domain, sir. GERD, the symptom will be like heartburn, chest pain. Sometimes it can GERD symptom can be misinterpreted as a cardiac problem. Same time, patients want a little bit comfortable diagnosis. Most of the patients having chest pain, real chest pain of anginal pain, they may interpret it as a GERD pain. They may take some PPI or antacid or H2 blockers. That will, as it, angina will stay for minutes, few minutes. This will also be relieved with H2 blocker or PPI. Patient may interpret it as a gastric symptom. He may misinterpret and may land in severe cardiac problem. Always burning chest pain with other cardiac risk factors like smoking, family history, hypertension, diabetes, all people should be, even though it seems to be GERD symptom, all people should be subjected for TMT 2D echo to rule out a cardiac complication. Other way, GERD will be associated with most of the times as it is a esophageal spasm. In turn, it can lead to what is called as a vasospasm of cardiac muscle also. Vasospasm of the cardiac circulation also will seems to be the same symptoms. That can be misinterpreted. This is not directly GERD, not directly related to CAD, anginal pain. Next.
Whatever it may be, the GERD patients should not ignore that it is simple GERD. They must rule out any cardiac problem before being comfortable by thinking it as GERD only.
Long-term use of PPIs. All heart attacks.
long-term complication of PPIs could lead to CAD, and the indirect like there was association. Once you if you use long-term PPIs, you will have H. pylori infections. Most at the your stomach pH is much disturbed. H. pylori bacteria is one of the cause associated with CAD. H. pylori will what is called as transpermeation. The lower gut organisms will come onto the upper gut organisms as you are continuously suppressing the acid pH of stomach. That is an indirect association of long-term uses of PPIs can lead to CADs. And also there is like most of the people using NSAIDs can have GERD. Same time the NSAIDs like diclofenac, there is a recent article in NEJM saying diclofenac can cause heart attacks. NSAIDs, which will be using for some orthopedic problem, can produce GERD. Patient may think of only GERD, but there can be CAD, anginal pain.
The next question, how different is hypertension of non-diabetic patient and patient with diabetes? What special care needs to be taken while treating such patients? What is your opinion about usage of benedipine in patients of diabetes with hypertension, Dr. Bhaskar Rao?
Benedipine is not a new drug, but it is a old calcium channel blocker with classical L and N type of blockade. When compared to cilindipine, it has some class effect like pedal edema, gum hypertrophy will be less with benedipine. The advantage of benedipine is these calcium channel blockers of fourth generation like pyridamine fourth generation, pyridamine derivatives, they will be giving renal perfusion will be good with benedipine, and the side effects of ARBs like nocturnal cough will be less with benedipine, and the blood pressure control will be prompt and according to what is called as a nocturnal dip, the maximum duration of action will be 20 hours. If you take benedipine at 6 o'clock, the more nocturnal dip will be at 2 a.m. to 6 a.m. So the physiological pattern of the normal dip and the blood pressure control will be prompt with the benedipine.
But the doctor fraternity here wants to know how different is hypertension of non-diabetic and diabetic? Is there any difference or both are same?
Most of the times with JNC 7 recommendation, if blood pressure has to be controlled in diabetics, beta blocker, if the beta blocker will not be choice, as there will be what is called as a hypokalemia and hyperglycemic effect of beta blockers will intervene with the glycemic control. So other choices like calcium channel blockers, ARBs or AC inhibitors will be antihypertensives of choice. But if there is a CAD or ischemic heart disease, then you have to use beta blockers, neglecting the glycemic side effects of beta blockers. So that is only the difference.
Is association of respiratory tract has been said to be associated with IBD.
Association of respiratory tract has been said to be associated with IBD. Pregnancy is a immunocompromised state like elderly people and children.
Just like any panelist.
Pneumonia is the third most common non-obstetric cause in pregnancy-related mortality. Pneumonia is the most common non-obstetric cause of mortality in pregnancy because pneumonia causes hypoxia and sepsis related acidosis. This hypoxia and acidosis will not be tolerated by fetus. That can be lead to preterm labor.
The question is, what are the common psychiatric disorders encountered in diabetic patients? We usually come across several psychological problems in a diabetic patient, but the moment we diagnose the patient as a diabetic disorder, there is a every possibility that patient may go into adjustment disorder, that the patient may not cope up the problem which the patient was diagnosed with the diabetes. So if the stress is not being relieved by simple tips of counseling or by not giving the proper education to the patient, the stress has been continued, then there is a possibility of going into the depression. So this depression, if you don't treat the depression properly, then this sad mood or low energy or improper executive function, this everything will lead to not properly taking medication. So again, this will have adverse impact over the diabetes. So sometimes the patient who has been suffering from the insomnia, then there is a possibility of taking benzodiazepines. So if benzodiazepine, the management of benzodiazepines is not properly done, then there is a every possibility of taking this medication for a prolonged period, then there is a possibility of getting addicted to these benzodiazepines. Sometimes in the late stage, due to depression and due to neuropathic problems, patient will have severe pain, tingling sensation and numbness. This everything causes patient to be taken inappropriate medication like heavy doses of amitriptyline, heavy doses of benzodiazepines, and sometimes taking alcohol for getting good proper sleep. So there is a possibility of getting addicted to the alcohol also. And sometimes the patient will start taking pentazocine, that fortwin injections. So we simply write one or two injections for the patient to get relief from these complications. But the patient, once he feel that he's getting good relief from this fortwin injection, there is a few cases I have come across that those cases getting addicted to this fortwin injection due to this diabetic neuropathic complications. So apart from this, sexual problems also we come across in this diabetic patient.
You ask your data.
Question, where is that again? Where branch at? You ask other branch, then we'll take.
Yeah.
No, you ask some other branch, then we'll discuss later.
What are the strategies and challenges to prevent the development of asthma or COPD in a diabetic patients, Dr. Dhananjay Ragar? The strategies and challenges to prevent development of asthma, COPD in diabetic patients.
3 to 30% of COPD and asthma
patients.
3 to 30% of COPD patients are diabetics. Actually, there will be stress in diabetes. Stress in COPD or asthma leads to diabetes. How? It can cause oxidative stress, or systemic inflammation, and hypoxemia can lead to our diabetes. One. And pharmacological treatment, steroids. We will use steroids both in asthma and COPD. For asthma, it is mortality benefit. In COPD, it is morbidity benefit. So glucocorticoids can increase diabetic levels. So better control of asthma and COPD can lead to less stress and less use of steroids. In that way, we can control diabetes.
Thank you, Dr. Dhananjay Rao. Good information.
Psychiatric.
Yes, effect of antipsychotics and antidepressants and glucose metabolism. Okay, yes, before going to this drugs and their effect over the glucose metabolism, then the disease itself, for example, the chronic major psychiatric disorder like schizophrenia and episodic disorder of chronic course of major depressive disorder, all these are said to be some kind of emotivational disorders, because the negative symptoms associated with these disorders will not help the patient to take any initiation into any some activity. So they don't feel like to go for physical exercise, and they don't feel like to take self-care, and they don't feel like to involve in certain activities. All these make a subject to be lazy and obese, and sometimes increase the weight put on. So these are all the risk factors for developing diabetes. And even apart from these characteristics and symptoms of the disorder, even the medication that we prescribe to the psychiatric patient, for example, atypical antipsychotics. These atypical antipsychotics, all these, I'm not saying that all these drugs are responsible for inducing weight gain or for increasing the blood glucose, but certain antipsychotics like olanzapine and clozapine, especially these two drugs, are very much causing damage to the patient by increasing blood glucose level and by increasing the weight gain also. So whichever the patient of a psychiatric patient, we need to be evaluate very carefully, like, because any family history of diabetes is there, or any pre-existing diabetes is there, or is there any risk factor in future you may be turn up into diabetic or not. So basing on this, we need to prescribe the medications. There are certain drugs with low potential of diabetogenic drugs, such as risperidone, quetiapine, and ziprasidone. So all these drugs have lower potentiality to cause blood glucose. So in the same way, antidepressants also, because taking these antidepressants, especially tricyclic antidepressant, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, combination of these drugs taking for a prolonged period, this might cause patient to be obese, and there is a possibility of increasing blood glucose. So, and among the drugs that has low causing of blood glucose is SSRI, that is sertraline and escitalopram. These are the safest drugs we can prescribe to the patient.
Thank you, Dr. Sairam. With this, we conclude the session of panel discussion. Now, it is now the turn of audience. What is your opinion about this panel discussion? And also, any queries, any interactions, you are all welcome. At least ask one question. Somesh sir has come to our rescue.
Dr. Bhaskar, obesity and GERD, are they two coexisting factors, or one is the complication of the other? Obesity and GERD, is it a complication of obesity, or they are just a coexisting factors?
Obesity increases GERD, chance of GERD by like two factors. The direct relation is, if you are obese, as you are obese, your diaphragm muscle also will be fat laden, it will be relaxed, so that you will have some hiatus. And the second thing is, the medication in this scenario, as you are having diabetes, you may use metformin. Metformin can produce GERD. If you are hypertensive, if you use beta blocker or a calcium channel blocker, which can lead to reduced gastroesophageal sphincter tone, GES, sphincter tone, so that there will be reflux, which can lead to GERD. And obese people, most of the times obese people will like fatty foods. The fatty foods will decrease the sphincter tone and increase the risk of GERD. Evening snacks, most of the times, like evening snacks like oily foods and those things will increase the risk of GERD. Late night dinners will increase the risk of whole, both the physiological factors, lifestyles, medication and obesity all can contribute to GERD. The individuals who have GERD at the early age can have Barrett's esophagus in their middle ages. Barrett's esophagus, to remind you, this is a columnarization of squamous epithelium of lower part of esophagus, which is one of the risk factors for esophageal carcinoma. And the people who use tobacco products, Kaini Gutka, can have GERD.
So essentially it is a complication of obesity.
Not exactly complication. The existing GERD will be increased with the obesity.
What are the chances of muscle cramps in diabetics?
Most of the times, the co-prescription being one is statins. Statins will usually produce muscle cramps, as there will be what is called as an Indian scenario, you will be losing ubiquinone. Once you use statins, you will lose ubiquinone, which can produce cramps. Another thing is, if you use metformin-like things, metformin will always cause B12 and folate deficiency, which can lead to cramps.
Properly managed with B12 and folate, the muscle cramps.
There is no underlying B12 folate deficiency, provided if you are on statins, you have to monitor CPK levels, creatine phosphokinase levels at regular intervals. If CPK levels are rising, then you have to reduce the dose or stop the statin. And another thing is, you can add, now the pharmaceutical preparations are coming, you can add ubiquinone or coenzyme Q to your statin. Uh-huh. So that you will not be having any cramps.
What is the best form of statin? Best form of statin to prevent the...
There is nothing like best form of statin, but the well-studied statin is simvastatin. Nowadays, there you have to individualize. If the patient is non-diabetic, better you avoid rosuvastatin, as rosuvastatin can produce diabetes. Uh-huh. In such case, you can use atorvastatin, which is very cheaper one, and you can titrate basing on lipid profiles very frequently. Even the low dose acts good, and also you can start at low, go slow and increase the dose. You can titrate until 80 milligrams if you suspect coronary artery disease.
Thank you very much.
Now with this, we conclude the panel discussion. The panelists, I am happy you have all, though it is a novel thing for us, you have all participated as if you are all well experienced, and in panel discussions, I am not suspecting their original intelligence and this thing. Panel experience, this is first time. As a moderator also, this is first time for me. So gradually I am improving myself.